Because Jesus Christ has satisfied the judgment of God, and because we have been forgiven and declared justified, we are now at peace with God. No matter how you feel, no matter what bad mood you get up in the morning, no matter how frustrated you may feel about yourself, you can know this with certainty and you can rejoice in it. I'm at peace with God.
This Christmas, give the gift that will last a lifetime and touch the heart of someone special in your life. In June 2015, Living Truth is hosting a journey to Turkey and Greece, following in the footsteps of Paul. Imagine giving your loved one the opportunity to travel to historic places mentioned in the Bible and offering experiences that deepen the understanding of God's Word. When Paul was in Athens, he stood on Mars Hill overlooking the Acropolis. He talked about the unknown God. When you stand in the same place, the words of Paul will come alive. You Athenians, I see that in every respect you are very religious. For as I walked around looking carefully at your shrines, I even discovered an altar inscribed to an unknown God. What therefore you unknowingly worship, I proclaim to you. In Turkey, visit Istanbul, historically known as Constantinople. Cruise on the Bosporus, with Asia on one side and Europe on the other, and experience the sights of modern Turkey. As well, this is an opportunity to embark on a spiritual journey. This is more than a vacation. In the middle of our journey, we'll stop and take a two-day retreat with time to reflect on the Word of God. Join Charles and Hilary Price as they teach from the Scriptures. We'd love you to join the Living Truth family. Make plans now for this once-in-a-lifetime gift. Our journey will include a four-day Mediterranean Sea cruise to Patmos, where John wrote the book of Revelation, a visit to the island of Santorini, the possible site of the lost city of Atlantis, and a walk through the medieval bazaar in Istanbul, all for the low cost of $3,995, plus applicable taxes and fees. To find out more, contact Christian Journeys or visit our website at livingtruth.ca. In Paul's beloved book, Romans, he makes some tough, unashamed statements about salvation, God's sovereignty, judgment, and God's righteousness. Paul wrote the letter to the Romans as a foundation for their faith. Righteousness is the moral character of God. So how's your character? Today's message is called The Fruit of Justification.
Let me read you now from Romans chapter 5. I'm going to read the first 11 verses. And we have been looking into the early part of this very important book of Romans over several weeks now. And in Romans 5 and verse 1, Paul writes, "Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand, and we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also rejoice in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God has poured out his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit, whom he has given us." You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous man, though for a good man, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? For if when we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? Not only is this so, but we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. That's as far as I'm going to read, but keep your Bible open at that passage. In the first four chapters of Romans, Paul has brought us to an understanding of both the need and the means of being reconciled to God and as a result, being declared justified. That's a key word in Paul's writings in the first part of this book. And we've talked about that over several weeks. But now in chapter 5 and verse 1, he follows this on with, therefore, since we have been justified through faith, he then goes on to say that certain important things must follow. Because being justified by faith is not the end, that is the foundation. And when the foundation is in place, that then is the beginning of a construction which is going to be a lifetime occupation for all those who belong to Jesus Christ. And I want to point out in the verses we have read, verses 1 to 11 of chapter 5, I want to point out a recurring word which I suggest you is the key to what Paul is saying in these verses. At least we will make it the key because this recurring word connects together everything that is in these first 11 verses. And see if you can pick it out. In verse 2, he says, and we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. In verse 3, he says, not only so, but we also rejoice in our sufferings. And then in verse 11, not only is this so, but we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received our reconciliation. Did you pick up the recurring word? It's the word rejoice. There's a few smart ones here. The word rejoice. On the basis of our justification, the growth that follows gives us reason to rejoice. Not only that, it is an escalating reason to rejoice. Because if I can put it like this, he says in verse 2, and we rejoice, blah, 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 and he tells us what we rejoice about. And then he says in verse 3, not only so, but we also rejoice in blah, 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 blah. And then in verse 11, not only is this so, but we also rejoice, blah, 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 blah. So he says, we rejoice, but not only that, we also rejoice, but not only is this so, we also, and then he adds this growing crescendo of rejoicing. And this is the consequence of our being justified before God. A legal word we've talked about before, which means that God has nothing against me because all that he had against me in his wrath and legitimate judgment has been met and satisfied in the work of Jesus Christ, and we are now justified. Now, let me look then at these three verses, these three reasons to rejoice. First is in verse 2, we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Now, let me read you the previous verse so we get these two verses to get the whole picture here. Verse 1 and 2, therefore, since we've been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we've gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand, and we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Once again, there's an escalating list of privileges here that come from being rejoiced. And it goes like this. First of all, since we've been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Many of you know the New Testament speaks about two kinds of peace in relation to God. There is peace with God, which Paul talks about here, and there is the peace of God, which Paul talks about in Philippians chapter 4, when he says, don't be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, make your request known to God, and the peace of God, which transcends understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Now, the first of these, peace with God, is objective. By that I mean it is outside of ourselves. It has nothing to do with about how we feel. It has everything to do with our position before God. Because Jesus Christ has satisfied the judgment of God, and because we have been forgiven and declared justified, we are now at peace with God. No matter how you feel, no matter what bad mood you get up in the morning, no matter how frustrated you may feel about yourself, you can know this with certainty and you can rejoice in it. I'm at peace with God. He's not my enemy, he's my friend. I've been embraced and been made part of his people. That is a totally objective statement. The peace of God is a completely subjective issue. It has to do with inner peace, has to do with tranquility of heart. It has everything to do with how we feel, because it has to do with the measure to which we entrust our situation to God. Now, that is something which in our own experience ebbs and flows depending on all kinds of factors we might be facing. But that subjective experience of the peace of God is not to be confused with this objective experience of being at peace with God. That is something on which we can be sure and confident that we're friends with him, we're at peace with him. But he goes on to say, second aspect of this, he says, since we've been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. Not only do we have peace with God, we have access through grace in which we now stand. We have access to God. The grace of God is God pouring upon us what we don't deserve. The word grace has often been used as an acrostic, G-R-A-C-E, God's riches at Christ's expense. And on the grounds of the fact that I'm at peace with God because I've been justified, I can also enjoy access to God and the experience of an ongoing relationship with a living God who is personally interested and involved in my life. You see, to be saved is not in itself to live the Christian life any more than to have been to a wedding and to be married is not the same as marriage itself. A wedding, you know, is fun, usually a bit tiring. We've had two in the last couple of years in my family that we've had to organize. Expensive too, by the way. But when the wedding is over, you don't say to the couple, well, that's it, that's done. Great, good. No, you say, now the difficult bit starts. Now you've got to learn to bring these two lives into unity with one another. Now this requires work and this will require discipline. You are going to go through hard times. You're going to go through hurts. You're going to go through disappointments. You're going to go through frustrations. But don't slacken when you reach those difficult times, because you'll come to a much richer place as a result of going through them and working through them. And that is a lifelong continuing journey. I know that because I've been married for 33 years. And sometimes it's not easy. Sometimes you've got to wrestle with issues. You've got to deal with issues that sometimes are painful. You'd rather just ignore them. And so is the Christian life. When Paul and Barnabas had been on their first missionary journey and they went back to the people who had become converts in places like Lystra and Iconium and Derbe, Acts 14:22 tells us what they said to them. They said to these new Christians, we must go through many hardships to enter the kingdom of God. He wasn't offering them a superficial happy ever after experience. He was offering them a life of work, a life of warfare, a life of hardships, if you're going to go and enjoy this Christian life. Because though we are at peace with God, we then have access to God by faith, and this access to God is going to put us into the situation whereby God is going to mold us and change us and stretch us. And again, we are bruised in the process because he is building something good and beautiful. And the third aspect he then says is, and we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Now, Paul has already talked about the glory of God, but not as a grounds for any rejoicing on our part. In fact, quite the opposite, because in chapter 3 and verse 23, he said, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. It's not a ground for rejoicing there. Rather, it's a ground for real sorrow, because the glory of God is the character of God, the moral character of God in Scripture. It's the measuring stick by which we've been found to fall short. And Paul has said to them, we've all sinned. We've all come short of the glory of God. This is discouraging. This frustrates us. But now in chapter 5, he actually says, we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Because the very thing that we have come short of and has frustrated us has now become a wonderful possibility to us. How has it become a possibility? Well, in Colossians chapter 1, Paul talks about a part of the gospel has been a mystery hidden for ages and generations. But then he says in Colossians 1:27, God has chosen to make known among the Gentiles the glorious riches of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. We rejoice in the hope of this glory of God. Where does it come from? Christ in you is your hope of glory. The fact that before we constantly fell because we were living independently of God, but now that we've been justified, we've been indwelt by the Spirit of Jesus Christ. He comes to live within us and he becomes the grounds of our hope of glory. It's not the grounds of our own ability, our own discipline. The grounds is that Jesus Christ lives in me. And his work in me is to will and to act according to his good purpose. And he puts within us this hope of glory. And one of the things that every Christian is predestined to, Paul gives a list of things we're predestined to in Romans chapter 8 and verse 30. And one of the things we're being predestined to is to be glorified. That is, that the glory of God that we've come short of is going to be fully restored into our experience. He says there, those he predestined, he also called. Those he called, he justified. Those he justified, he also glorified. So being justified is a major event in our lives. And the next major event is that we are going to be glorified. That is that as a continuing process through this life, as Paul wrote in 2 Corinthians 3, verse 18, we are being transformed into his likeness with ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit, until one day in heaven we will actually be glorified. To be glorified is to be fully restored into the image of God. And I have reasons to remind my wife that one day I'm actually going to be Christ-like. But not yet. So be patient. I have to die first. But in the meantime, there needs to be more evidence that that is the journey I'm on this year than I was last year. More growth in godliness this year than there was last year, because this is something now about which we rejoice. So what Paul is saying is now you're justified. You have peace with God. You have access to the grace of God. And we have the prospect of sharing the glory of God. And this is the first ground on which we are to rejoice. Are you rejoicing over that? This is all about you and God, this aspect. I'm justified, at peace with him, have access to him, and he is making me like himself. That's a very good reason to rejoice. It's a very good reason for your wife and husband to rejoice as well, if God is doing that in your life. Because this makes you better people, makes us all better people, as Christ works in us and through us. But then the second thing that we're to rejoice in is in verse 3, because then he says, not only so, but we also rejoice in our sufferings. Uh-oh. That's a strange one, isn't it? That kind of throws a cat among the pigeons. It's been nice up until now. But rejoice in our sufferings. You know, I can imagine that when Paul wrote this, somebody could come to him and say, Paul, you've just talked about being justified. You've talked about having peace with God. You've talked about having access to God. You've talked about rejoicing in the hope of the glory of God. And all that sounds great. But looking at your life, Paul, you're always in trouble. You are usually sick in your body, because Paul had said to the Galatians, he talked about his frequent illnesses. You are poor in possessions. In fact, you're just like most people around you. In fact, you're on the lower level of the life that most people around you seem to live with your kind of material things. And you seem to be suffering just as much as everybody else. And Paul's reply would be, yes, that is true. But there's a difference. And the difference is this. We rejoice in our sufferings. That's the difference. Our sufferings are not our enemies, but our friends. This is a foreign message to many people. It's a foreign message, unfortunately, to many Christians. There's a very popular gospel around that sees no value in suffering and looks for health and wealth as being evidence of the blessing of God. This is not the gospel of Paul, and it was not the gospel of Jesus. It was not the lives that they lived. The life of Paul, who wrote this, was characterized by suffering. And not simply that he tolerated suffering, not simply that he learned to be patient with it, that he put up with it, but that he actually rejoiced in his sufferings. Now you can hear sermons or you can read books on how to handle suffering and how to manage suffering, how to reduce suffering, how to get rid of suffering, but you don't find an awful lot on how to rejoice in your sufferings. And yet this is the radical message that Paul is saying to these believers. Now you're justified, you're equipped for certain things, and one thing you need to learn to rejoice about is your sufferings. He wrote elsewhere in Philippians 3 and verse 10, I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection. Well, that's all very good. But then he says, and the fellowship of sharing in his sufferings. I want to know this. Hebrews 5 verse 8 says about Jesus, although he was a son, he learned obedience from what he suffered. He doesn't say, although he was a son, he became exempt from suffering, but rather this was a means in his life by which he learned and learned obedience. So why is suffering part of the Christian experience, and why are we to rejoice in our suffering? I'll give you three reasons from these verses. First of all, verse 3 says, we know that suffering produces... Let me stop there. I've underlined those two words in my Bible. Suffering produces. We'll look at a moment in what it produces. But suffering is presented by Paul as a creative force in our lives. And we need a New Testament understanding of suffering that is not to be avoided at all cost, but when it comes to us, to be harnessed and to be embraced as a productive force. Now, it's important to qualify that by saying this, that let's be very tender, very kind, and very understanding of those who suffer. This doesn't give us grounds to be callous or to be indifferent because people ought to rejoice in their suffering. That is one of the toughest callings they will ever have in their lives. But rather, the scripture tells us, we are to weep with those who weep and mourn with those who mourn. But let us at the same time recognize that God does deep things in people's lives through suffering. It's not fair just to tell people that at the time. We normally learn this with hindsight. At the time, weep with those who weep, mourn with those who mourn, encourage, come alongside. Where we can help, let's help. But I know from my own experience, I've learned an awful lot more from my tears than I've learned from my laughter. Both are part of life, but we learn more from our tears. To some extent, we can't avoid suffering. In John 16, 33, Jesus said to his disciples, in this world, you will have trouble. That's a promise to them. I've told you what Paul just said to the churches he founded on his first missionary journey. You must go through many hardships. That's going to be part of their experience. And the important thing here is not the reality of suffering, but our attitude to suffering. And the attitude that Paul gives us here is simply, we rejoice in our suffering. Not because we become masochistic, masochism is finding pleasure in pain, but we rejoice because suffering produces. It is creating something better and bigger. Second thing I want to point out here, suffering produces is the first. Second is suffering matures. Because if suffering produces, what does it produce? Well, he says, verse 3 and 4, we rejoice in our sufferings because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance, character, and character, hope. So it produces three things. And these three things are marks of maturity: perseverance, character, and hope. You see, suffering will either become a creative force in our lives to create something positive, or it'll become a destructive force in our lives and lead us to become bitter and angry and negative. Perseverance is the first thing it produces. Why? Because you stick with the situation you're in, and that perseverance produces character. You know, God doesn't take away suffering. It's what makes us. It matures us. It builds us. You know, in the Old Testament, God's blessing was seen in prosperity amongst the people of God, the Israelites. In the New Testament, God's blessing is seen through adversity. That has a much higher place in the New Testament. The King James Version of this says, we glory in tribulation, knowing that tribulation works patience, and patience experience, and experience hope. And I quote that because he says tribulation works patience. And I want to tell you a story of Watchman Nee, a great Chinese leader, been in heaven for many years now. But Watchman Nee tells that a lady came to him one day at the end of a meeting. He was speaking out and said to him, would you please pray for me? He said, what do you want me to pray for? She said, I need patience. I need to pray for patience. He said, madam, would you like me to pray that God will give you patience? She said, yes. He said, are you sure? She said, yes, I desperately need patience. So he said, let's kneel together. And they knelt down together and he said, God, I don't know, worthless effect. God, I don't know anything about this lady's life except that she needs patience. So I pray that you'll bring into her life such difficulties, such hardships, such tribulation that she won't know what to do. And while she was praying, this lady got up and grabbed him and said, stop, I've got enough of that. He said, madam, you don't understand the scriptures. Tribulation works patience. You get as much patience as you learn to deal with tribulation. So your need is not patience. Your need is tribulation, ma'am. Hope you enjoy it. I don't know if he said that, but this is true, isn't it? We want the nice bit. Lord, give me patience. May the wind never blow and nothing ever rock and nothing ever roll and everything be comfortable. What a boring life. Now you say, Lord, make me a patient person. He'll put you through difficulties where you have to persevere and stick with it, because that's also what's mentioned here. So suffering produces and suffering matures. And thirdly, suffering softens in verse 5. He links the progression of suffering and perseverance and character and hope. And then says, and hope does not disappoint us in verse 5, because God has poured out his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit, whom he has given to us. He says, you stick with this suffering in which you rejoice that leads to perseverance and character and hope, and you'll discover this, that hope will not disappoint you because God will pour out his love into your hearts. We often experience more deeply the presence of God in our difficulties and our troubles and our sadnesses. A lady who was on the journey with us this last couple of weeks, she said to me, I lost my husband and my son within 3 months of each other, both unexpectedly. I said, how very sad that has been for you. She said, yes, it has. But she said, don't feel sorry for me. Because through this very painful time, God has done things in my life that would never have been done. And I've experienced his presence and his love like I never did before. Suffering suffering softens. You know, if we don't respond to it by rejoicing in our suffering and offering that to God, rather than soften, it will harden us. I've known people who have been battered by circumstances who have become bitter as a result. I know people who have been battered by circumstances who have become beautiful as a result. This lady was one of those. And Paul says, you have grounds here to rejoice, not only in the glory of God, but rejoice in your sufferings. If you like, if the first rejoice is the spiritual world, the second rejoice is very much in the real physical world, where we find trouble and difficulty. But when Paul talks about rejoicing in the hope of glory and then rejoicing in our suffering, he is not changing the subject. Because in chapter 8, he brings them both together. Chapter 8 of Romans, verse 17. Now, if we are children, then we are heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ. Listen to this. If indeed we share in his suffering, in order that we may share in his glory. If you want to rejoice in the glory of God, says Paul, a means by which you do that is by rejoicing in suffering. And he says in the next verse, I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed to us. Sharing in his sufferings is conditional to sharing in his glory, and the pain of our sufferings are nothing compared to the joy of his glory. This is a radical view of suffering. But it's the view of the New Testament. And so Paul says, I rejoice in the hope of sharing the glory of God. I rejoice in my sufferings. And thirdly, he says, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. Now, we need to put that into the full context of verses 10 and 11, because there's a twofold aspect of reconciliation, which is the grounds of our rejoicing. Because he says in verse 10, for if when we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him to the death of his son, that's the first ground of rejoicing in our reconciliation, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? That's the second ground of our rejoicing in our reconciliation. Because not only is this so, but we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we received reconciliation. Let me talk briefly about those two. We were reconciled to God through the death of his son. This, of course, is similar to what Paul has said about being at peace with God. That this aspect of our reconciliation is a past tense one. When we were God's enemies, we have been reconciled to God through the death of his son. But notice there are things that are past tense which are now present tense. Great danger often in our Christian lives is we get pulled back into the past tense rather than enjoying what is the present tense grounds of our rejoicing. You see, Paul makes very clear that our salvation is not based on our ability or our deservedness, because in verse 6 of Romans 5, he says, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. That was our condition. We were powerless. Verse 8, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. So we were sinners. Verse 10, when we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his son. So here's his description of why we need reconciliation with God. One, we're powerless. Two, we're sinners. Three, we are by nature enemies. Those are three important things for us to understand. Several years ago, I was in Germany, and I was invited to go and speak one night at a home for recovering alcoholics. And it wasn't your normal run-of-the-mill place. It was actually, at the time, an experiment that the German government were doing, whereby they provided the most luxurious environment with the highest quality of things available, and they'd selected a number of professional, well-educated, intelligent people who had been overtaken by alcoholic addiction, and they brought them into these surroundings. They had quite a strict regime, and the idea was to restore to them dignity and self-esteem and purpose. And occasionally they would invite a speaker or somebody to come and do something one evening. It wasn't a Christian organization. And I was speaking in the area. It was in southern Germany, not far from Stuttgart. And I was invited to go on this particular evening to have a meal with them first and then to speak to them after the meal. And it was an amazing meal. I know, about five courses, and you had all the right cutlery and serviettes and some things like that, which they're good at in Germany. And you know, we had this great meal. The idea is that you put people in an environment that is so beautiful and good and wholesome, it'll help them, is the theory. Afterwards, we went into the lounge area. It was, I don't know, 60 of them or so. I've forgotten exactly the number. And they said, you know, we often have a speaker, and we've invited this gentleman, Charles Price. He lives in England, which I did at the time, and he's a preacher. He's a Christian man. And he's in this area, and we invite him to come and speak to us tonight. So my introduction was something like that. So I got up and I said, it's good to be here. You know three things about me on the basis of that invitation. You know I come from England. That may or may not be a good thing. You know I'm a Christian. That may or may not be a good thing to you. And you know I'm a preacher. That may or may not be a good thing to you. But in that introduction, you have formed impressions about me. Now, I don't know what your impressions about me are as an English person. Let's leave that aside. But I wonder what your impressions are by the fact I've been introduced to you as a Christian and as a preacher. I said, I'd like you to tell me what that says about me to you, and be absolutely honest. I don't mind if it's bad stuff. Just be absolutely honest. Somebody said, well, you know, you're probably a pretty good person, or at least you think you are. Okay? Somebody said, you don't mess up like other people, maybe. Somebody said, you're probably a bit pleased with yourself, maybe slightly. I said, thank you. Do I look that way? Yeah, well, maybe. Somebody said, you think you're better than most other people. And they gave me a few things like that. And I said, okay, so the impression that you have of me, simply by knowing I'm a Christian and knowing I'm a preacher, is that I'm maybe a good person, or I think I'm a good person. I don't mess up other people. I'm probably pleased with myself. I probably think I'm better than most people. I said, how many people here would qualify to be a Christian on those grounds? Just put your hand up and say, yeah, that's me. Nobody put their hand up. I said, I'm going to give you three qualifications for being a Christian. And they were all here in Romans 5. Let me read you what Paul says. Verse 6, you see, at the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. I said, the first thing you know about a Christian is that he's powerless. What does that mean? It means he can know what he wants to do, but he can't actually do it. So like Paul, what I do is not the good I want to do. No, the evil I do not want to do. This is what I keep on doing. First thing about a real Christian is they're powerless. Second thing is in verse 8. God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. The word sin comes from archery. You take an arrow and you aim it at the target and you release the arrow. And with the best intention in the world, you miss the target. So you try it again. And with the best intention, you miss. And I said, If I'm a Christian, what I'm telling you is this. Not only am I powerless, I'm telling you that I aim at the target, but I miss it. I aim intentionally, but I keep on missing. That's what it means. The third qualification being a Christian is in verse 10. If when we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his son. That means that someone who becomes a Christian is somebody who actually has worked against God. They've lived as his enemies, not for him, but against him. So now, being a Christian means I've discovered these three things about myself. I'm powerless. I keep on missing the mark. I live as an enemy of God. Let me ask you, how many of you would qualify to be a Christian on those terms? And they were kind of a little bit hesitant, looked a bit shy, a little bit looking around, but one guy said, all right, put his hand up. Another guy did. In a few minutes, every hand in the room had gone up. I said, every one of us in this room today is in exactly the same boat. We're powerless. We miss the mark with the best intentions in the world. We live as enemies, not friends of God. But when a man, a woman will acknowledge that about themselves, they're on the threshold of the biggest discovery they could ever make. That I can be reconciled to God because I'm honest about myself. And I'm sure every hand will go up in this building as well. And we rejoice in the fact that if we were God's enemies, we've been reconciled to him through the death of his son. Not reconciled on the base of anything we do, and reconciled on the base of the death of his son. He has broken that barrier and restored us to God himself. And the second aspect of that verse is that having been reconciled to God by the death of his son, verse 10, how much more, here's something more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? It's the death of Christ that reconciles me to God legally, but then it is the life of Christ that is implanted within us that reconciles us to God experientially. Not just legally, I am now reconciled because sin has been taken away, but by his indwelling life, by the Spirit of Jesus Christ living within us, experientially, I can know him and enjoy him. And this is much more, says Paul, than the legal reconciliation. This is to be enjoyed every day. I've referred to that many times, and we haven't time to talk more about that this morning. But you know, when you lay a foundation, said Jesus, make sure when you lay the foundation, you're willing to construct the building, and that's a big job. And a lot of people in enthusiasm lay the foundation, okay, I'll come to Christ, I'll be justified, I'll be born again of the Holy Spirit, but then they just drift and they go into the assumption that my Christian life is just going to happen by osmosis, and it won't. It doesn't happen just by coming to church. It's intentionally getting to know God and developing my walk with God and relationship with God, and you cannot do that outside of the Word of God. You know, I'm very encouraged on Sunday mornings. There's so many of you now open your Bible when I say I'm going to read from a certain passage and you read it with me. And I'm thrilled by that because it's a pretty good sign that you probably open it at home as well. But I'll be very honest with you. I am discouraged. Some of you have been here week after week, month after month. You've been here for years. You never bring a Bible. Incredibly foolish trusting me to tell you what it says without checking it for yourself. But I would suspect this too. If you don't bring it and open it here, you probably don't open it at home either. You can't grow that way. You can lay the foundation, but there's no growth. There's no building. And as Jesus said about that, that everyone who sees it begins to ridicule him, saying, this fellow began to build and was unable to finish. Because you have been justified, therefore, says Paul, you've laid the foundation. Now construct the building, and you can do it in a context of joy. You rejoice in what he's provided for you and your communion with him and your his grace that brings you in touch with him. You can rejoice in the fact that when the world throws anything it throws at you, you rejoice in your sufferings because this is what matures you. This is what brings you to that point of softening you in your experience of the love of God. And you rejoice in the fact that having been reconciled to God by the death of his son, you're now enjoying the life of his son living in you to be all that you need to live every day. But you won't know that just as a bullet point of Christian doctrine. You know that by getting to know God himself in his word, through his word, letting him speak to you, you speaking to him, and building in your own heart and life that communion with himself. Let's pray together. Lord, we thank you this morning that having saved us, and I pray for any who don't know in their experience what that salvation means, that you'll bring them quickly, maybe this morning, into a knowledge of that, of humbly surrendering their lives to you and inviting you to forgive them on the basis of the cross and come and live within them by the Holy Spirit. And forgive us as a result when we face sufferings and difficulties. We see them as the enemy only, and we fight them and try and get rid of them, and we scar others in the process, and we don't embrace them and say, this is a means by which God is going to produce perseverance and character and hope. And hope is not wasted because the Holy Spirit pours the love of God into our hearts. Make us our experience, we pray. Make us men and women who genuinely love you, who know we're loved by you, and we rejoice in our salvation. For we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Watch this message again, go to our website, livingtruth.ca. You can also order DVDs and CDs, download transcripts, sign up for our monthly newsletter, check out the Living Truth Daily Devotional, sign up for podcasts, and read faith stories from other viewers. We love to hear from you, so send us your comments and testimonies. Living Truth is supported by viewers like you. Thank you for transforming lives through your financial participation. Tune in to Living Truth next week for a special Christmas message from Charles Price. The book of Romans reveals the answers to important questions and provides information on many topics such as salvation, the sovereignty of God, judgment, spiritual growth, and the righteousness of God. In Paul's beloved letter, he makes some tough, unashamed statements about God's righteousness. Paul wrote the letter to the Romans as a concrete theological foundation for their faith. This series by Charles Price is available on CD and DVD. Learn at home, give to a friend, or plan a group Bible study. To order this series, write to the address on your screen or call +1 416 222 3341, extension 113. To order online, visit livingtruth.ca. Righteousness is the moral character of God. So how's your character?